For the next hour, I will talk a bit about the experience that we have in Leuven with the PET-MR system, and I will discuss also a bit the clinical projects that we are having with the PET-MR system. So I will start with a kind of a general overview of the PET centers in Belgium, also with all the kind of PET tracers that we're using at our center. Then I will discuss a bit more in depth on the methodology development, so the medical doctors can take a power nap then. And then at the end, I will discuss also a bit the clinical projects that we are running on the system. So to give you a bit of an idea and to start with the real big difference between MR and PET. So MR allows mainly to visualize structural, functional and molecular tissue with a high spatial resolution, also with a high tissue contrast. And these are different images to show you these. So these are different MR sequences. So you have a lot of possibilities with MR to visualize different properties of tissue. On the other hand, PET is more a quantitative approach. So with PET, you can do more accurate quantification of biological processes. And you also, it's quite sensitive. So you only need a small amount of PET tracer to be able to quantify or to visualize a specific process. Actually, we are in the range of picomolar sensitivity, and so actually, this is a bit my job within the department. So I'm mainly working on PET quantification, so the kinetic modeling, and then basically we would try to simplify this kinetic modeling using SVR or other measures to really be able to use this in translational research, but also in patient care and drug development. So this is a bit to give an overview of the PET centers in Belgium. So we are 10 million people in Belgium. I think it's a bit more, like 10.5. So and now we will have up to 24 PET centers in Belgium. So this is actually the Dutch-speaking part. So this is the Dutch-speaking. So here you have the language border, and this is the French-speaking part. So most of the PET centers are equally divided between two parts because we need to keep the balance. So and here is Leuven. So Leuven is really in the center of Belgium. And so we recently got this extension of PET centers because we also got the extension of indication. So we will probably go from 45,000 procedures a year to 86,000. So it will be like a doubling of all the procedures. And there was also a change in reimbursement. So that's why we can now increase the number of PET centers. And then specifically for the KU Leuven, so for the UZ Leuven, so basically it's a university hospital. It's actually the campus of the biomedical sciences, so everything is centralized within one campus. It's a site with 200 hospital beds, so we get a lot of internal people being referred by the clinicians. We are like a department of 81 people, that changes a little bit, and we are doing like 18,000 examinations a year, but that's for all the examinations within the department. In general, we do like 1/3 our PET scans. And then we also have some experience with radionuclide therapy, but that's rather limited. But basically at Leuven, we master the full pipeline of PET imaging, so that basically means that we can do radio tracer synthesis on site, so we can produce our own PET tracers. We also have the PET imaging facilities on site, so we have 2 PET-CT systems and 1 PET-MR systems, which are supported by a highly skilled team. And then we also have a lot of experience with really the data reviewing and quantification. Essentially, if people are scanned in another PET center, then we basically ask the images and we do the quantification sometimes, again, just to make sure that the quantification is done in an accurate way, especially if these patients need some follow-up in Leuven. And then we also have a strong collaboration with the Center of Clinical Pharmacology, also for this contract research studies. And then we also, of course, because now we have a PET-MR, we are also strongly working together with the Department of Radiology. So that's a bit to give you the picture of our site. And this is then a short overview of our GMP facility. So we produce our PET tracers in our site. But it also means that we need to do it according to GMP, a good manufacturing practice, because we are also selling DFDG to other PET centers. So we need to comply with GMP. And basically, we have got a grant from the government of Flanders to extend this lab. So we have now a capacity of 16 synthesis modules. And basically, that was a question also during lunch. During the morning, we basically synthesize F18 traces. And then in the afternoon, we synthesize our carbon 11 traces. And we have also some partnerships with private partners. The most important private partners are Janssen, Merck, Siemens, and GE. So that's also give a bit of an idea. And this is then the tracer that we use in the clinical routine. It's limited to these tracers. The ones with an asterisk were actually reimbursed by the healthcare services. So these are mostly the tracers in blue are the one for, well, DFDG is like a multi-purpose tracer, but the others, blue ones, are for the brain. The green ones are more for the oncology, and then the red ones are for the cardiac applications. And these are the traces that we can synthesize actually, and the ones in bold are the ones that we are currently running a project with. It's perhaps good to mention the tau tracer, which is used currently, also the tracer for neuroinflammation, the DPA714. But then we have also now some studies running with pharmaceutical companies like with J&J. We are running a PET study on the AMPA receptor. And also with the Martineau Center, actually, we are running a PET study on the HX6. And what we also do now is we use PIP instead of the other commercial available amyloid tracers. So because that's basically much cheaper for us to use instead of a commercial tracer. That's just to give a bit of an overview. So what is the focus within the department in terms of research? So we are mainly focusing on dementia, on amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, so on ALS patients, also on Parkinson patients, epilepsy, and brain tumors. So on multiple sclerosis, there's not a focus yet. Perhaps in the future that would be possible. And then to support this research, we actually got funding to install a simultaneous PET-MR system. So it's a system from GE. It has the biggest advantage compared to the Siemens system is that it has time of flight. And this time of flight actually means that you will have a better contrast, also better spatial resolution. We are now, this is a bit too optimistic, I think we are at around 5 millimeters. It also has higher sensitivity and less artifacts. And so this time of flight PET system is then combined with the 3 Tesla MR system, which basically can provide a state-of-the-art MR imaging possibilities. So that's a bit to give an idea about the system. So when we started using this PET-MR system, there are obviously some challenges, and this is more like the methodological part. One of the challenges with PET-MR is actually the attenuation, because with MR you're measuring proton density. So you're not really measuring electron density, which basically gives you essential information about the attenuation properties of your tissue. So, and especially in brain, that could be a problem because the brain, well, the brain is surrounded by skull, and that has a big attenuation effect on your PET signal coming from brain tissue. So what we actually developed, it was a kind of a collaboration with GE, is to use this zero echo time sequence, which actually is an MR sequence which allows to pick up the short T1 signal from the cranial bones. Because this bone, as you probably know, it has a very low concentration of water molecules, so it's very difficult to excite this and to get a signal from the bone. But if you have this really quick sequences and you get a good excitation, you can basically pick up the signal. And that's actually what is shown here. So this is actually kind of an acquisition that we've done with the ZTE. And then you can actually extract from this sequence the bone structure. And if you compare this to a CT, it's very similar. So this is the surface rendering of a skull using the ZTE sequence. This is actually the surface rendering using a normal CT system. And you can actually see that the data in both data sets is very similar. So that's why we then would try to use this to compensate for attenuation or to model the attenuation. And actually, it worked very well because this is actually the attenuation map using the CT. And you can see that the cavities, especially at the lower skull base, they are modeled very well because it's a CT. The standard method that was used by GE up to then was this atlas-based approach. So they use this kind of CT atlas and they merge the PET data with the CT atlas. But you can see then that especially at the lower part of the skull, the cavities are not so patient-specific. And if we then introduce this ZTE sequence, you can see that the cavities are modeled in a much better way and also much better in a patient-specific way. So that means that if we then, because we scan some patients double, now we actually didn't scan them double, we scanned them on the PET-MR, but they also got the CT, so we could use the CT map. So we reconstructed data sets of like 28 patients, both with the Atlas-based, the ZE-based, and the CT-based, and then we compared. And so the Atlas-based has much more difference compared to the ZE-based, compared to the CT-based, if you could compare it to the ZE-based. And the most important is actually, it's shown in the next slide. So this is the Atlas-based, and if you use an Atlas-based approach, you actually get a gradient through your brain. So you will have a higher bias on the upper brain regions compared to the lower brain regions. With the ZE-based approach, this gradient vanishes. So this is, again, comparing these data with the CT-based approach. But this means that if you would like to use a reference tissue, like you're doing with amyloid PET, and if you're using the cerebellum as reference region, then you could introduce a bias, especially if you're comparing the cortical regions relative to the cerebellum. So that's why we're now standardly using this approach, and it's very similar to PET-CT approach. One of the other things, of course, if you're having a PET-MR system, is that you know that the resolution of the MR is much better. You want to use the high resolution of the MR also to improve your PET. And there are different approaches for this, where we're also doing research on. So this is the standard reconstruction. This is standard reconstruction that you will get from your PET-MR system. And this is then a reconstruction which is guided by the segmented MR data. So basically you're segmenting the MR data in a gray matter compartment and a white matter compartment. And then you can actually apply some conditions to the PET reconstruction, saying, okay, within a similar compartment, the changes in activity can't be too big. So that's basically how you can improve your resolution. Of course, for this approach, you need a segmentation, and a segmentation can also go wrong. So this is an approach that we developed where you don't even need a segmentation, where it basically looks at similar voxels in the MR. And if it finds a similar voxel, it also wants to induce the similarity in the voxels in the PET data. So that's basically to balance your reconstruction, your PET reconstruction, using your MR data. But it is very time consuming. It's also very challenging because you need to have access to the raw data. So you need to discuss with the vendor what the format is of these raw data. Now, for this study, we had an agreement with GE, but for other centers, it's not that straightforward. So what we then did, we also applied a kind of a different approach. So the old approach was that basically we would feed in the PET raw data, we would feed in their high resolution MR, and then you would have this automatically guided iterative reconstruction to generate this improved data set compared to the standard PET reconstruction. And of course, the drawbacks are this reconstruction takes a lot of time. It takes half an hour to 2 hours. So, and this is for one frame. So if you have a dynamic scan, it takes even more. So that's not really practical. Also, as I mentioned before, you need to have access to the PET raw data. And so we need to discuss with the vendor if he can open up his secrets. So that's why we apply this kind of deep learning model, where basically we feed in the standard reconstruction and we feed in the high resolution MR data. And then we train a convolutional neural network such that he can actually deliver also an improved PET data set. And the advantages are that once the network is trained, it goes really fast. It only takes a few seconds. And you don't have access to the PET raw data because you can start from the reconstructed data, you can start from the MR, and then basically it will give you an improved data set. So that's much more flexible and can also be used in much more centers. This is actually just for your information. This is the architecture that we use for this fully convolutional neural network. It's multiple layers and it's deep learning because it has a lot of internal layers. And then to give you an idea about the results that we obtained, these are the results. So this is the golden standard. So this is the reconstruction using the other approach. And these are then the improved PET data that we could achieve with this convolutional neural network. And these are then the regular PET reconstruction that we get from our scanner. So you can see that we are really well in line with the old reconstruction using the raw data. And even that the noise is not really important. So we can use either lower activity or we can reduce our scanning time, especially for pediatric patients. So that would also be one of the advantages of using this approach, that you can either reduce the dose or reduce the scanning time. And so this is also to illustrate this. So this is then the difference that we get from the ground truth. So it's very small. And this works, I think, this because you need to be a bit cautious because you're training a network, so you could also induce some bias. I think it works well for FDG scans, like if you're looking at patterns or if you want to quantify using for neurodegenerative disorders. There's also the scan of a patient with a brain tumor, so you will see the brain tumor here. And we also apply this approach, but then you see that there is some difference in visual perception between the standard reconstruction and the reconstruction taking into account the information from the MR, because there probably the information from PET and MR is kind of complementary, so you should there be a bit more careful about using the MR to improve your PET data. So what we also do, since we want to use the MR as much as possible to improve the quantification of your PET data, there's also a project that is running here with Anna Maria. It's basically that we use the karyotypes. So because in general, to quantify your PET data, you also need an input function. And mostly this input function is acquired by putting an arterial line, and then you measure the activity levels in the arterial blood. But what you could actually do is also try to estimate the activity from the karyotype. So these are the arteries which go into the brain. But from the PET-only data, it's quite challenging because these are small structures, so it's difficult to estimate them and to estimate them accurately. So what we're now doing with PET-MR is acquire simultaneously an MR angiography, which basically visualizes the arterial arteries. And then based on that, we can have a much more straightforward segmentation of your arteries and then apply the segmentation actually to the PET data, which should be in line because they are acquired simultaneously. And then we actually can get a really nice input function. So this is also a thing that we are working on. We're now close of really starting to use it actually. So then also in terms of methodology developments, FDG PET is still very often used, especially in the diagnosis of dementia, where you really need to discriminate between different uptake patterns for the early detection and diagnosis of different types of dementia. But of course, in terms of classification, this is quite a challenge because basically you will have your whole brain volume, which basically means that you have a lot of voxels, and these voxels actually represent a feature vector of a large dimension. So you will have a lot of features, and you will have basically, especially in neuroimaging, a limited number of samples. You will only have a limited number of scans, but a lot of voxels. So enable to train a network to do a classification based on this approach, it's very challenging. And so what we're doing at our center is to use a classifier which can deal with this high dimensional data. So these are the kind of kernel methods. And the one that we are using now is this support vector machines, which basically tries to separate two classes by actually maximizing the minimal distance to the distance plane. And that basically means that to define this distance plane, you only need a limited number of data sets. So you only need a small number of training data, and that's how it can actually deal with these high dimensional data. And this is to give you an idea. So this is how we use it now to classify healthy controls from patients with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. We actually train the network such that it has this kind of diminutive pattern. And then basically if a new patient comes in, we project his data set onto this pattern, and then we calculate a kind of a pattern expression score. And so if this pattern expression is really high, we are quite sure this is actually a patient with this type of disease. And so for ALS patients, this works quite well. We actually achieve an accuracy of around 94%. But I must admit that also this classification approach, from a visual point of view, is not that challenging. If you have a skilled medical doctor, he will also be able to achieve the same amount of accuracy. So that's why we try to do it in a more challenging problem. And actually, we went then back to the preclinical setting where we could control the disease state much better. So we actually had a disease model for Parkinson's disease, where basically we used a lentiviral vector to have reproducible nigrostriatal pathology within the 4 weeks. So basically, this lentiviral vector was causing some accumulation of alpha-synuclein, and so you will have this progressive dopaminergic cell loss. And so we did this in a PD model in rats, So we initiated the model, and then we did some longitudinal scanning with FDG at week 3, at week 4, at week 9, 6, and at week 9. And then basically, so we would assume that we would get a difference at week 4. So basically what we did, we used the same approach, and we actually calculated this disease-specific pattern using week 9, where the disease would be complete or is expected to be complete. And then for the previous time points, we actually projected these data sets onto this pattern of week 9. And we could actually see that at week 3, we couldn't find a difference between the two groups. So we had a control group and we had a disease group. But from week 4 on, so once that we assumed that the disease is kicking in, we could actually discriminate both groups based on the score of the pattern. And that was actually very well reproduced at week 6 and of course at week 9, because also at week 9 we basically used these data for training. So that was also to demonstrate that this kind of approach could also be used to pick up the disease at an early stage, not really at the final stage. Basically, you could make your pattern based on the final stage of the disease, but then even you could use this pattern to kind of try to detect it at earlier stages. Then one other thing that we try to do with PET-MR is basically get rid of the FDG scan, because the FDG scan will not allow you to use a more specific PET tracer. So that was the idea, to basically use arterial spin labeling instead of FDG and combine it with a more specific PET tracer. Like if you would have an Alzheimer patient, that you use DASL and like a tau tracer or like an amyloid tracer, because that would give you much more flexibility from a cost perspective. That would also allow you to save some costs. So that's why we also try to see whether the information that is provided by the arterial spin labeling is in line with the information that we get from an FDG scan. And just to have a short recap, how arterial spin labeling works. So it's basically gives you an estimate of the brain perfusion, but without using a contrast agent. So it uses the endogenous blood as a contrast agent. So basically you will have a slice here where you tag the arterial blood which is coming into the brain. So you will label this one. And then after a delay, you will scan different slices in the brain. And because the arterial blood is labeled, you will have a disruption of your signal there. And then you also do a scan but without labeling the arterial blood, and then based on the difference you can have an idea about the distortion of your signal, and that also gives you then an idea about the perfusion in your brain. So this is how it works. Actually, we now use an approach with 3 delay times, because it depends a bit on your age and also on the slice that you're imaging, how fast the labeled blood will move into this brain slice. So this is how it essentially works. The acquisition takes around 9 minutes. So you're very prone to movement, because if you move between the tagged scan and the baseline scan, then you will have also some bias in your quantification. But this is actually the data that we get from it. If you compare this to an FDG PET scan, I think the noise level are much higher in this scan. But anyway, so we compared both actually. So we looked at 30 control subjects and also 27 patients which were referred to our PET-MR system for cognitive deterioration. And so they got a routine PET-CT scan, because this is required for the clinical workup. And then subsequent, they also got a PET-MR system. And then based on this data, we actually compared the ASL, so the arterial spin labeling, with the FDG on the PET-MR. And so they were scored both in a visual way and a semi-quantitative way. And so what we actually saw is that in terms of differentiating between normal and abnormal, FDG still got an accuracy of 86%, which is a kind of what was expected. The ASL, the accuracy there is not that high. It was around 72%, so it's like 15% lower. But this, for the controls, the FDG performed really well. For the controls also there, the doctors thought that at some point there were some patients which, so some controls were considered as a patient. So, and then if we looked at the correct patient classification, so the accuracy there was kind of similar, FDG versus ASL. But then specifically, if you look at the AD patients, you could see that FDG really scores higher there, like 87% compared to the ASL, where the AD diagnosis was really challenging. It's like only 50%. So, and there was actually some discordant reading, because this is then an Alzheimer patient, female, 37 years old. And you can see with the FDG scan, there's quite a pronounced sign of Alzheimer's disease with this specific region which has hypermetabolism. But this was actually not visual in the ASL. So there also, there's still some discordance in the image information. And also, if we looked at two patients with frontotemporal dementia, and we compare this to the 30 healthy controls, you could see that the pattern you would expect with frontotemporal dementia is really pronounced in FDG. In ASL, you see some pattern popping up, but it's not that significant and also not that easy to interpret. And the same then for the hypermetabolic regions, where for the FDG it's much more pronounced, it's also much more widespread, and for the ASL it's limited. So in terms of interpretation, it's really challenging to replace the FDG with the ASL, and I think for the moment we will still stick to the FDG scan. Brain aging, you get increased gray matter atrophy with age, and especially you also get a frontal hypometabolism. And so we wanted to confirm this with our PET-MR system, and we also wanted to integrate information from diffusion tensor imaging, so DTI. And basically what DTI does is it measures the directional water molecule diffusion in tissue, so it really looks at brain microstructure, and it actually gives you an idea of the integrity of your white matter tracts. And one of the measures that is then used is fractal anisotropy, and so it basically represents the relative diffusion amongst fiber tracts. And so basically a decreased FA of fractional anisotropy represents a loss of tract integrity. So, and we know from literature that there's actually a decreased FA in specific tracts in AD and MCI patients. So we wanted to know really, is it also present in healthy aging? So do you lose some of your white matter integrity? And is this to some extent related with changes in glucose metabolism in the gray matter? So, and this was then the results of the study. So this was the protocol, so it was a simultaneous PET-MR. So the PET scan was done for 1 hour, and simultaneously then with this PET scan we filled in different sequences from the MR. So in the beginning we are doing only silent sequences, not to activate the auditory cortex. And then this MRAC are really the attenuation maps that we want to generate at different time points, also to take into account motion. So this was then the ASL, this was the resting state of MRI, and these are then the anatomical scans. And finally, at the end, we had also the DTI sequence. So this is basically how a sequence is built up. And these were then the results. So as expected, we saw a decrease in frontal glucose metabolism, even after a correction for partial volume. But what we also saw was that the FA declines with age, especially in the superior coronal radiata and also in the anterior corona radiata. So the same behavior was present both in the prefrontal cortex, in the frontal cortex, and also in the white matter bundles. And actually we saw, as expected, a kind of a correlation. So basically that means that if you get a decrease in FDG uptake in the prefrontal cortex, you also get a decrease in your white matter integrity in specific bundles which are really linking the frontal cortex. So that's also quite a nice finding, actually. So then we also are doing now some studies on synaptic density. We have validated a new tracer for this. It's the ECBA tracer. It's labeled with carbon 11, and basically it binds to SV2A. And SV2A is actually expressed in the vesicles presynaptically, so it can measure the density of brain synapses throughout the whole brain. And actually this tracer is a derivative from an anti-epileptic drug, it's levetiracetam. So this is the signal that we get, so it's a really high PET signal, and you can see that the signal is uniform throughout the whole brain, kind of uniform. So with this tracer we wanted to study actually the synaptic density in brain tissue. It had a good quantification, so the kinetics was kind of fast. The test readers was also very, very acceptable, so it was less than 10%. And so we also looked at the reference tissue, and this was actually determined using a dose occupancy study. So this was at baseline, and this was after blocking the SV2A. And you can see that the blocking was significantly in all brain regions except for the white matter. And that's why we now then used subcortical white matter as a kind of a reference tissue to normalize all our data. And we also demonstrated that actually this full dynamic scan could be replaced by a static scan between 60 and 90 minutes. So that's how we then get a protocol which can also be used for clinical patients. So we know that we can only need to measure statically for half an hour with no invasive procedure, because we can use the white matter as reference tissue. And also this half an hour allows us to run different MR sequences. So, and also because we were quite convinced that it has a different information compared to FDG, that's why we also compare this on a voxel level, so both the synaptic density and the glucose metabolism. We found a correlation in a lot of brain regions, but in some brain regions, like in the thalamus, the hippocampus, and also the occipital cortex and the insular cortex, there was not really a correlation between the synaptic density and the glucose metabolism, which led us to assume that there is complementary information present in both traces. So that's why we want to move forward with the UCBA trace, so with synaptic density. So we did this kind of pilot study in an MCI group. So we included 10 healthy controls and 10 amnestic MCI patients. The groups were balanced in terms of gender, and they were also age matched. And we also included another tracer, which is specifically measuring the tau deposits in the brain. This was also a tracer that was introduced in our center in 2016. It was actually developed together with Merck. It has limited off-target binding, so it's only binding to the paired helical filaments of tau. And it has also good quantification, so it only has a test retest below 10% and relative fast kinetics. And for this tracer, you can also use the cerebellum as a reference tissue. So we actually combined both of these tracers in a group of MCI patients. And also, like for tau, it's already demonstrated that it has a correlation with your clinical symptoms also. So that's also one of the advantages of tau. And so what we actually could see in this group of MCI patients, if we compare the MCIs to the controls, is that, as we expected, the tau uptake in controls was really low. It's at baseline. In the MCI patient, it was significantly higher in the temporal, the mesotemporal, and the hippocampus. But we saw the other effect in terms of SV2A, so we saw a reduction in synaptic density in the same regions for the MCI patients. So that was actually a very interesting finding, that there actually is a correlation between the deposition of tau and the synaptic density. And so we could also demonstrate that, especially in the hippocampus, so in the hippocampal regions, there was a significant correlation between the synaptic density and the tau, so you will get a decrease in synaptic density if you will have an increase in your tau deposits. So this is now being written out and submitted. So we also tried these two traces in a stroke. So this is a patient, but this is really preliminary data, so we only scanned a few patients. So this is 3 weeks after stroke, and this is 6 months after stroke. So this is actually kind of in the acute phase. This is more like in the chronic phase. So this is the tau uptake. So you see at the, around the stroke lesion, a very high uptake of the tau traces. So we are not quite sure how specific it is there, because you have a disruption of your blood-brain barrier. So it could also be that there is a lot of leakage of the PET tracer into brain tissue. On the other hand, you still see some synaptic density in these areas. And then after 6 months, we see a complete disappearance of the tau uptake, but we also see a complete disappearance of synaptic density. So it could be that this is actually due to the blood-brain barrier that is restored, so then you will also get your tracer out. And this is probably also because at this phase you're losing a lot of your synapses. But this is only like preliminary data, so we're still wondering how we should interpret these data. And then we're also looking at imaging the dopamine neurotransmission in the brain. So what is now used in clinical routine is the FPCT scan. So that's a scan labeled with iodine-123. So it's looking at the DOTS transporter. But this is a SPECT tracer, so one of the disadvantages of SPECT is, of course, the quantification and also the resolution. So that's why we are now working with a new tracer. It's a PET tracer, actually. There were some PET tracers available. But just to give you an idea in terms of selectivity, so this PET tracer, so it's the PE2I, has much higher selectivity only for the DOT transporter. It has a very low affinity for both the serotonin receptor and also for the NET. So that's why this race is much more specific than the FPCs. And if you then compare it, a head-to-head comparison, so we're now busy with a head-to-head comparison. So these are patients which receive both a DOT scan, so an FPCT scan, and also a P2I scan. And you can appreciate the difference in image quality. So this is a Parkinson patient, this is with the FPCT scan, and this is then with the PET scan. So you see much better resolution. Also, we were able to quantify this data much better. This is a healthy control. You also see the very nice shape of the basal ganglia. So also in terms of quantification, and to compare actually the pathological values with the normal range, this will give much more opportunities. So we are now trying to roll this out also in clinical to really get rid of the FPCT scan and to have all Parkinson patients scanned with PE2I. Also in terms of patient comfort, because Betamar is such a high sensitive system, we only need like a 10-minute scan because these patients tend to move a lot. So also there, if we can reduce the acquisition time, it's really a step forward. And also in terms of cost, it's still quite okay because with one batch of this tracer, because it's a fluorine 18 labeled tracer, we will be able to scan multiple patients. So we'll be also working a bit in the field of neuroinflammation, and there we are working at new targets, which are basically more situated on the outer membrane. So we are assuming probably that they are more sensitive, and perhaps we can also divide between different subtypes of microglia. We did some efforts to develop a tracer which targets CB2. We actually did some clinical studies. But basically, all of these were negative. So I think CB2, I think the tracer that we had so far, the affinity was too low. And now we are running clinical studies with P2X7, so tracers which target P2X7. We demonstrated in an animal model that we had specific binding. So P2X7 doesn't bind to rat P2X7, this tracer, but so we had to overexpress human P2X7 in rat model. But that basically worked also with lentiviral overexpression, so we could demonstrate that we have a specific binding in this model. And we could also demonstrate in a non-human primate that we could actually block the signal, which also indicates that we have a specific binding. So we did our first MN study in 2017, and the studies are currently running. So to give you a bit of an overview, and that's I think where we will go in the next years, is that we will combine the common molecular pathways of both neurodegeneration and neuroinflammation, and we will mainly focus on protein misfolding, excitotoxicity, and also neuroinflammation. So, and for this, we also have a tracer. So we have the mGluR5 receptor, which is involved in the excitotoxicity. And so basically, we will combine this tracer also with TSPO tracers, because I think that the P2X7 is not really suitable at this moment, and combine this either with tau or with amyloid PET. So this is a bit the research direction that we will go in. And then perhaps to finish this presentation, I would like to discuss also a bit the collaboration that we have with pharmaceutical companies. Also to help them to develop new drugs. There's a bit like the quote that our head of department is always using, like we have a new wonder drug, and the wonder basically means that we are really wondering what it will do. But we get a lot of questions actually to help with drug development, because the challenge is actually to reduce the costs. Because like the years that you need to really go from a discovery phase into really a clinical setting takes now 10 to 15 years. That's always also a bit tricky in terms of patents, because most of the patents are only valid for 20 years. So if you can only go into the market after 15 years, then you only have like this 5 years where your patents will still cover your discovery. And so the estimated cost for developing a new drug, which is so successful, is now estimated at 1 to 2 billion euros. Which is very expensive. So in order to make this drug's discovery course a bit more successful, we actually are giving support really at the phase one part. And that basically means that we do help the the industry, both with target identification. Then we also provide them with the means to validate their new drugs in a model, in a small animal model. We can then basically also help to design a PET tracer which targets the same receptor as their drug is targeting. And then basically we can help them also with the first in men to demonstrate whether there's target engagements, doing real accurate quantification. And so basically that will help them to design both a drug together with a PET tracer. And this can then be used for further drug development, but also for clinical research. So a lot of the PET tracers that we have developed together with pharmaceutical companies, we can actually use them also for clinical studies. And then in the really best case, we can also use these new PET tracers for patient care. So this is how it works actually. So this is a study that we've done with flumazenil, and they wanted to know whether they had some effect in the brain. So this was a placebo. So basically this is a subject which was dosed with a specific drug. And basically what we do is, so we scan each of these subjects at baseline, then we drug them, and then we scan them again. So and if you will have an effect of your drug, you will have actually the competition of your PET tracer with your drug, which basically means that your PET tracer will have less binding sites. So that also means that the signal of your PET tracer will be lower. So this is clearly to demonstrate this. So this is a baseline scan, then we drug the patient. So there is a competition with the PET tracer actually, so we will have a lower signal. So here you clearly demonstrate that there is an effect of your drug in the brain. And then of course this effect will go away because your drug will get cleared from your body. And so if you do a scan even at later time point, you will see that the PET signal actually recovers. So that's basically how we demonstrate that there is an effect of your drug. If you do the same thing with the placebo, you can see that the post-drug scannings, so this is done after administering the placebo, that there's no real difference between your post-drug scan and your placebo. So this basically means that there is no effect. So if you show these data to a company and you show this type of data, then they really know that the drug is having no effect in the brain. So and how does that then work in practice? So this was a question from Merck because they wanted to avoid the overdosing of an anti-emetic drug. So basically what we did also is that we acquired baseline scans with a specific tracer which also targets the same receptor as this anti-emetic drug. And then after drug dosing we scanned again, and so we could have an idea about the receptor occupancy of this drug. And so this is actually this curve that we then get. So these are different dose levels. And these are actually the receptor occupancy, the percentage of receptor occupancy in the brain estimated for the different doses. So they used to dose at this regimen, but basically it appears based on our PET study that you get the same receptor occupancy, the same percentage receptor occupancy with a lower dose. And this was actually also confirmed by the response by patients. So they didn't see a significant difference in response between these different dose regimens. Which basically means if they would have done this before using this drug in patients, they could have started from the beginning with this dose regimen. So it's clearly also that if you really would like to target 100% occupancy, this dose is too low because you will be at like 80% of occupying your receptors. But this dose regimen is more than enough to have a full blockage of all your receptors. So this is actually how we can help pharmaceutical companies, not only with demonstrating that the drug works, but also to select the appropriate dose to go for further clinical trials. And this is also to demonstrate what is the advantage actually of using a simultaneous PET-MR system. So this is also a single dose PET occupancy study we did for UCBA. So this is actually using the UCBA data, so the UCBA tracer, so we're looking at synaptic density. So they had a new anti-epileptic drug, and they wanted to know what the dose was needed to have like 60 or 70% occupancy of your SV2A. So it's again the same design. So we did a baseline PET-MR scan, then the drug was administered, it was Padcevenil. Then we did the first post-dose scan at 2 to 6 hours, so depending a bit on the plasma levels. And then we did a second post-dose scan at 24 to 30 hours. So here there was 1 day in between. So we included 10 healthy volunteers, and so there was only the administration of a single dose. Sometimes we can also have this study set up where we have multiple doses, so we do the dose, then we have the post-dose scan, we do the dose again. That's also to see what the occupancy is in a more like a repeated dose setting. And so we could see definitely that the Padcevenil is working, because you could see that the post-dose signal is much lower. For these different doses, between 106.25 milligrams, we got an average occupancy of 60%. But then, if you look at the dose occupancy level, so this is again the receptor occupancy, this is the plasma levels, you can see that actually it goes to a plateau, and that at the plasma level of around 50, you're already at a very high occupancy level. So it's not useful to dose at higher doses, because you're saturating your SV2A at that doses. But we also wanted to know, coming back to the ASL, whether we could also get extra information from the perfusion measurements with MR, which was acquired really simultaneous with the PET data. So there it's really an added value to have a simultaneous PET MR, because you will have a snapshot of the situation with both PET and MRI. And so what we basically did is we compared the ASL data from the baseline with the first post-dose scan. So then we had the highest occupancy, because it was very shortly after the dosing of this drug. We had 82% occupancy. And you could see that we saw a change in perfusion in specific regions. And we only saw a decrease in perfusion. And if we then look at the literature, actually we could reproduce a pattern which was basically assumed as a pattern which is related to triazolam, or like a drug-induced non-REM sleep. So basically, it means that this drug really dumps the working of the brain, and you get this kind of sleepy mode. And it was actually quite interesting. So then we saw this kind of differences, significant differences in brain perfusion for specific regions, especially for the posterior cingulate cortex, the cerebellum, the thalamus, and the brainstem. There was negative trend in some other regions, but this was not significant. But if we then look at the second post-dose scan, which was at a later stage, and where we got a reduction in occupancy, because we were now only 40% occupancy, we actually didn't observe this pattern anymore. So even there, like, if you reduce your occupancy, you will also reduce some of the side effects of your drugs. Because I think these patients, and it was also clear from the clinical parameters that they took, that these patients were less sleepy. So that could also be observed then with a simultaneous perfusion measurement using MR. And so actually, if you also looked at a void-based analysis, you could see actually that the perfusion was recovering in brain regions where the perfusion was first significantly different. You could see that all of these perfusion was again going to baseline status. So that's actually also quite a nice example of why it's sometimes beneficial to use a simultaneous PET-MR. And we could actually, based on this data set, demonstrate that there was a negative correlation between the perfusion, the brain perfusion, and the SV2A occupancy for specific brain regions. So that could also help with selecting the appropriate dose if you know that there will also be an effect on brain perfusion. So to conclude, the simultaneous PET-MR, is there a killer application? Is it really worthwhile to do the investment? It's not quite a clear answer. At our institution, we are only using it in a research setting. And actually, we are mainly using it for contract research, so there's dose occupancy studies. We also use it for clinical studies, but you can always argue whether a simultaneous measurement is really necessary, whether, especially for the clinical studies, whether you could also consider to have a separate PET scan and a separate MR scan, and then combine both of the data afterwards. We believe for some a study setup, it's definitely an added value, especially if you want to do a pharmacological challenge, or if you want to do a cognitive challenge. So if you really change the state of your patient, and it's very difficult to reproduce that state. And also in terms of network analysis, like doing a resting state, I think there also, if you want to do a resting state fMRI and combine this with PET data, I think also there it's an added value to do it really simultaneously. Also in terms of behavior, if you have an episode, I think also there it would be really worthwhile to do it simultaneous. And of course, you have this one-stop shop. So if you have some patient groups which really are not keen on getting into a PET scanner or into an MR scanner, then you can really combine both scanning sessions in one session. So it's a more like a one-stop shop approach then, which could be convenient for specific patient groups. But it's not quite clear whether it's really a good marriage at the moment in terms of an investment. So I would like to acknowledge all the people who are working on the PET-MR project. I would like to thank you for your attention.